بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Topic of today is the upper respiratory tract primary pathogens, Corynebacteria, diphtheria, and actinomyces. We mean by this the primary pathogens of the upper respiratory tract, that those pathogens which essentially produce upper respiratory tract infection. They cannot be considered as normal flora. They are not part of the normal flora of the upper respiratory tract. Means when they are present, they must produce a disease, a lesion. Okay? This could be bacterial and viral and fungal, of course. But here we'll start talking about the bacterial causes, primary bacterial causes of upper respiratory tract infection. Usually, these bacteria, they got into the upper respiratory tract through droplet or airborne infection. They colonize in the mucosa epithelium of the upper respiratory tract and adheres to it, as we studied before. First step is adherence or colonization, then multiplication. And starting showing their virulence, either by produced toxins, either by or by invasion, direct invasion of the mucosa or of the tonsils, etc., etc. This organism, very few organisms show to cause true disease. Yani, primary pathogens, they are not much, and yani, actually they are not so common. But we'll talk about this. The first organism is Streptococcus pyogenes, group A streptococci. It's not that common, but it's dangerous because it may complicate, it may be complicated by rheumatic fever, rheumatic heart disease, or kidney glomerulonephritis. So that's why we stress, make stress on group A strept. This comprises only 15 to 35% of the pathogens. Also, other groups of streptococci, beta hemolytic, like C, group C, and group G, they can produce as well upper respiratory tract infection, and this range from 3 to 11%. So now we have Streptococcus hemolyticus or beta hemolytic. Beta hemolytic streptococci, groups A, C, G. Next to that, there is what we call, or what's called Arcanobacterium hemolyticum. Yes, also Arcanobacterium hemolyticum, range from 1 to 10%. Then there is Fusobacterium necrophorum. This is anaerobe, and it's complicated by Meslier disease or jugular vein embolism, and it can cause dangerous complication. This is anaerobic bacteria. Neisseria gonorrhea or gonorrhea, Neisseria gonorrhea also can cause exudative lesion in the upper respiratory tract when it reaches this site. The Haemophilus influenzae, especially the capsulated strains, can cause proglottitis, inflammation of the epiglottis, and this in children may cause a sort of suffocation, and it's dangerous as well. Only proglottitis. Of course, H. influenzae can be present as upper respiratory tract flora. This is one exception here. And the last one is the last organism is the Corynebacterium diphtheriae, the toxigenic strains. That means the strains that produce diphtheria toxins of Corynebacterium diphtheriae can cause diphtheria, what we call diphtheria. Lesion in the pharynx, in the nasopharynx also. Only the toxigenic strains of this bacteria, otherwise it's commensal. We'll talk first about the special cases of upper respiratory infection that we enumerated before. As you said, H influenzae, this called the so-called epiglottitis lesion. It can lead to airway obstruction if not treated in children especially. Combined effect of anaerobic flora, mainly the Fusobacterium microflora, and with other anaerobic flora, but actually this, yani, someone will say, okay, this is part of the flora, why we consider it primary? Yes, they are part of the flora, but being just in the oral cavity, they do not cause the disease. But if there is a trauma or a deep wound in the oral submucosa, this anaerobic flora may extend and invade the deeper tissue and cause what we call Vincent angina. It's a membrane-type exudative pharyngitis, similar to diphtheria, but with foul odor. And as I said, in some of these, especially the Fusobacterium microflorum, can cause Miller's syndrome, which is formation of thrombus in the jugular vein, and this thrombus may lead to death, or it may be fragmented and spread all over the body. Also, Klebsiella rhinosclerosis, this causes rhinoscleroma. Klebsiella uzini causes what we call uzina. It's a lesion called uzina. It's a granulomatous lesion in the nasal mucosa. These are special cases of upper respiratory infection. If we talk about the opportunistic upper respiratory tract infection, so we are talking about the candida when it causes oral thrush under certain circumstances of depressed immunity or prolonged antibacterial chemotherapy. So it can cause what we call it oral thrush. Also, in granulocytopenic patients, these are immunocompromised conditions, some enterobacteriaceae or Staph aureus may cause pharyngitis. These are special cases of upper respiratory tract infection. About the viral pathogens that cause upper respiratory tract infection, these are many, numerous, and maybe now it's a coronavirus is one of them. Rhinoviruses, adenoviruses, respiratory syncytial viruses. The list is long. The influenza virus and the parainfluenza, the coronavirus, the Coxsackie A and B, the cytomegalovirus, the Epstein-Barr, the herpes simplex 1. All these viral pathogens may cause upper respiratory tract infections with different manifestations. We have to and keep in mind these 10, at least these 10 pathogens should be in our mind. Okay, now we'll give some hints about these bacterial pathogens, starting with Corynebacterium diphtheriae. These are gram-positive pleomorphic clots. Pleomorphic means that it can have different lengths and different figures under the microscope. They are facultative anaerobe. The cell wall of Corynebacterium contains mycoric acids, and this reminds us of the tuberculosis. But the mycoric acids here are contains less number of carbon. They have metachromatic granules seen with Loeffler methylene blue stain or Albert stain. And metachromatic granules, different colors in this granules in this organism. Anyway, a gram stain shows Y and V shaped bacilli arranged in chains and at right angles to each other, or making angles with each other, so that we call it Chinese letter appearance. This is the Corynebacterium diphtheria. The Corynebacterium diphtheria, as I said before, not all of them are toxigenic, not all of them are pathogenic. Only the bacteria which is inhabited by special phage, bacteriophage, will acquire the ability to produce the exotoxin diphtheria toxin, which is very, very dangerous and very serious toxin. It's a type 3 toxin, means A and B exotoxin. It contains two units, A and B. The B unit or B subunit contains a receptor binding region and a translocation region, and the A subunit contains a catalytic region, and this will enter into the cells and exert the toxigenic effect on the cell. It is cytolytic, by example. For example, yani, by the way, the diphtheria toxigenic is a cytolytic toxin. Receptors for this toxin, the diphtheria toxin, is a heparin binding epidermal growth factor present on many leukocytes, many eukaryotic epithelial cells, particularly the heart and nerve cells. We have to stress on this, that the heart muscles, heart cell, heart myocytes, and the nerve cells contains receptors for diphtheria exotoxin. That's why we find the manifestation of this disease in the form of heart decompensation or heart failure, and as well motor failure, motor nerve failure, or motor paralysis. This is how the toxin affects the cells. By toxin A, subunit A inactivates the elongation factor 2 necessary for the movement of nascent peptide chain on ribosomes, and this is will stop the protein synthesis in the cell, in the target cell, and this will lead to degeneration and necrosis of the cell. The turnover of the elongation factor 2 is very slow, means that one molecule of the exotoxin is enough to produce a permanent damage. Cessation of the entire protein synthesis in the cell. Diphtheria exotoxin is a potent toxin. Here we said before the role of lysogenic phage in toxin producing, that there is a phage infects the bacterial strain and enables it to produce the exotoxin. Okay, a lethal dose is very, very, very little for the diphtheria exotoxin, 0.1 microgram per kilogram body weight. Okay, here the diagram shows how the bacterial exotoxin enters the cell, and it inactivates elongation factor 2 at the ribosomes and prevents protein synthesis, leading to cell death at the end. Diphtheria is present everywhere in the world. The disease observed in unvaccinated people. There is a vaccine for diphtheria exotoxin. It's an antitoxin. It's a toxoid that produces an antitoxin in the body. And also there is antitoxin prepared in horses that can be injected or given to the exposed person to stop the action of the exotoxin in his body. So there is a vaccine, and there is a zero prevention by ready-made exotoxin. The humans are the only known reservoir for this organism. They carry the organism in the oropharynx or on the skin. And by exposure to the spit droplets of the carrier or of the case or skin contact, the healthy person can get infected. Due to the massive vaccination of the children by the toxoid vaccine, diphtheria is a rare disease nowadays. DTP, low diphtheria, toxin, and pertussis and tetanus, these three, three vaccines in one, they are given to infants in the three occasions during infancy and early childhood. This figure also shows the diphtheria global annual report and DPT coverage. With increase the coverage by the DTP vaccine, DTP3 vaccine, we find that the number of cases are decreasing. The clinical disease of diphtheria can be just asymptomatic colonization in the immune person. Yani, if this toxigenic strain attach and colonize the pharynx of an immune person, the immune person will not express the diphtheria disease. More or less just mild respiratory disease or asymptomatic or mild respiratory disease in partially immune individuals. And of course, in the non-immune individual, it can cause fulminant disease. Respiratory diphtheria, which occurs, as you said, in non-immune persons, shows a sudden onset with exudative pharyngitis. There is inflammation in the pharyngeal mucosa with exudates and the membrane. There is sore throat, there is low-grade fever and malaise. And this membrane is a necrotic membrane. It is a pseudomembrane, actually. It develops over any area of the pharynx. And this pseudomembrane is nothing but dead cells of the mucosa, mixed or together with some pus, and they form a pseudomembrane. When we try to remove this pseudomembrane from the mucosa, the mucosa will bleed because you are elevating the mucosal necrotic mucosal layer. So what's next is the submucosa. Submucosa contains capillaries, so it bleeds. And this is different from the membrane formed by either group A strept or the candida, the oral thrush. If you remove the pus or this membrane, the white membrane, nothing will, no bleeding. We'll just find a hyperemic mucosal cell. This is in group A strept or the candida. But in diphtheria, the membrane will leave bleeding, will leave spots of blood. In critically ill patients, this membrane may cover, especially in children, may cover the airway, the larynx, extend to the larynx. It's called breathing obstruction. The toxins invade the bloodstream and reach the heart, called cardiac arrhythmias and cardiac failure, muscle failure. It can cause coma. It can cause a paralysis of respiratory muscles. This will lead to death. A In the non-toxigenic strains may cause mild pharyngitis. They also may invade the bloodstream and cause endocarditis. The non-pathogenic or non-toxigenic, non-toxigenic Corynebacterium diphtheria. Here some figures. Above to the right, diphtheria, notice the pseudomembrane in the posterior pharynx. It can become very large and may obstruct the airway. And on the left side, there is cutaneous diphtheria, and it's just ulceration of the skin. How we diagnose diphtheria? If we take a swab from this membrane, we'll find just gram-positive rods with characteristic metachromatic granules, and the classic arrangement of the Corynebacterium diphtheria bacilli and other Corynebacterium. It's not specific, because as we said that Corynebacterium diphtheria and the non-diphtheria can be part of the oral commensals. So we have to culture this part of this membrane or swab from the membrane. We should culture it on non-selective medium, blood agar, as well as on selective medium called cysteine telluride agar or serum telluride agar. So we have to culture the swab on a non-selective blood agar and a selective called cysteine telluride agar, which is a blood agar also, but contains cysteine and telluride. And we have to test the growing organism on this medium, if it is toxigenic or not. So we have to do what we call LX test. It's an immune test, in vitro test, or PCR amplification of the toxigen production gene. We have to make sure that this organism or this strain is exotoxin producer. Otherwise, it's a non-pathogenic diphtheria. This on the upper left blood agar plate contains telluride, or chocolate agar plate containing telluride, and here plate contains cysteine telluride agar, shows the colonies of diphtheria with black discoloration. Here this is demonstrating the LX test. The principle of the LX test: we grow the test organism, and we put perpendicular to the organism, we put a strip of filter paper, so with antitoxin. So we find a tangential, or I mean, line at 45 degree about for the degree line of precipitation. Due to the binding of the toxin with the antitoxin. So this means that LX test is positive. Here on the left side, there is toxigenic strain and non-toxigenic strains on the right side. This staining picture shows the metachromatic granules and how the bacilli makes angle with each other, so we describe them as Chinese letter arrangement. Anyway, this also few plates showing the Corynebacterium diphtheria. Fine. And the treatment of diphtheria is an emergency. So if someone is infected with toxigenic strains of diphtheria, he must get antibiotic in the form of penicillin, large dose of penicillin, plus the antitoxins, prepared antitoxin, as we said, in ready made antitoxin in ox or horses. We inject them with this antitoxin, and we try to support or reverse the pathogenic effect on the heart, on the muscles, etc. And of course, respiratory aid, and in order to make a patent airway for the patient. Anyway, the next topic is actinomyces. Actinomyces. Actinomyces are facultative anaerobic bacteria. This is anaerobic bacteria. Except Actinomyces merii, they are in the form of, or they appear in the form of filaments or hyphae-like filamentous rods. That's why the name actino, actinomyces. They are non-acid fast. They grow slowly in cultures. They cause gradual chronic infection. Actinomyces grow slowly in culture. It reminds us of Microbacterium tuberculosis. They have gradual, slow growth. That's why they produce chronic infections. They never produce acute infections. Many species are known of the Actinomyces. Well known, or the most famous, is Actinomyces israeli. They are, as we said, facultative anaerobe, with exception, merii is strict anaerobe. This is a picture of a figure of Actinomyces israeli in tissues. We note here the filamentous nature of this bacteria, long, elongated, filamentous, and maybe branched. Of course, it's gram-positive. Pathogenesis of Actinomyces, usually Actinomyces inhabit the upper respiratory tract, also the GIT, the female genitourinary system, but never the skin. They do not inhabit the skin. Usually, the infection is endogenous. No person-to-person spread. No, the bacteria that invades comes from you, from the patient, with the endogenous infection. When they find any mucosal abrasion or wound, they sneak into it and start to do slow replication and infection. They have low virulence. And as we said, they are only pathogenic if the innate immune response or the natural barrier of the mucosal, oral mucosa is damaged. So they are opportunistic. If the mucosal barrier is disrupted by trauma, by surgery, or by other infections, so they can cause a slowly progressing actinomycosis. Actinomycosis is a chronic granulomatous lesion. Again, it's a chronic granulomatous lesion. Don't expect a patient coming and tells you that this swelling in the jaw or in the submandibular region appeared within 1 day or 2 days, and you think in actinomycosis. Never. Never actinomycosis develops in 1 or 2 days. It needs 2-3 weeks to develop. So remember this. It causes chronic granulomatous lesion. This lesion will suppurate, produce pus. This abscess formed will send sinuses through the skin, and these sinuses will have like pits, ثقوب على the skin, and from these pits or these holes, small tiny holes, a sulfur granule pus will appear. If you press the lesion or swelling, a pus comes out from these sinus holes, and you'll find that this pus is yellow, and when it touches or is exposed to the air on the skin, they will dry out and form something like crystals, like sugar crystals, but they are yellow in color. And we call this sulfur granules. They are granules, sandy granules, like sand, for example, and the color is yellow. That's why We call them sulfur granules. Okay. There is no sulfur in the pus. It's just because الكبريت اللي هو السلفر ده بيقلونه اصفر عشان كده ايه ده تشبيه بس لكن ما فيش فيها كبريت يعني الباس ده ما فيش فيه كبريت ولا حاجه ده بالعكس ده هو فيه هنلاقي فيه لو بصينا تحت الميكروسكوب ويل فايند ايه كولونز اوف ذا بكتيريا اللي احنا شفناها قبل كده دي وباوند توجذر باي كالسيوم فوسفيت يبقى هي القصه كلها ان فيها كالسيوم فوسفيت ما فيش فيه ايه ما فيش كبريت في الموضوع ولا سلفر ولا حاجه ده شكل بس المنطقة الـ area of suppuration بتبقى surrounded by hard granulation tissue وبتبقى عاملة زي ايه كأنها بون يعني كأنها ايه كأنها بون بتبقى hard مش ابس كده طري لا بيبقى hard بيبقى عامل زي كأنه خشب woody consistency يبقى دي كلها صفات للليجن بتاع الاكتينومايكوز هنلاقي نمرة واحد ريليتد للاورال كافيتي يعني في اي جهه في السكين بتبقى بتبرز على السكين محيطه في الابر ماكزيلا لور في على الجو لور ماكزيلا سب مانديبلر ريجن كده ابر بارت اوف ذا نيك هيبقى ديفلوبس او الليجن هيبقى ديفلوبينج اوفر ويكس هيبقى في عباره عن سويلنج جامد تخبط عليه كده بالبالبيشن تحس ان هو خشب ها هارد هنلاقي فيه ساينسز مالتيبل ساينسز كده والماينس لو احنا ضغطنا على الليجن الساينس دي هيخرج منها جرانيولز صفراء سلفر هنسميها سلفر جرانيولز زي الساند كده زي الرمله وصفراء ناخد الجرانيولز دي نصبغها نلاقي بالجرام ستين هنلاقي جرام بوزيتيف فيلامنتس ومعاها شويه باس سيلز. فالكلينيكال برزنتيشن بتبقى ذا فورم اوف سيرفايكوفيشيال اكتينومايكوز بيبقى نتيجه بور اورال كافيتي اورال هيجين وفي عندي انفيزيف دنتال بروسيدور حصل للمريض ده والمريض ده ما عملش اورال هيجين كويس ما اتطهرش كويس الدنتال بروسيدور اتقفل على وفي باس جوه او في بكتيريا ما اتطهرش كويس فبيحصل جراديوال بينلس سويلنج ات ذا انجل اوف ذا ماندبل اند ذا نيك اريا دريننج ساينس تراكت اتسترا طبعا الساينس دي لما بتهيل لما بتقفل بتعمل سكارنج ها زي ما اتفقنا ان ده كرونيك فبيحصل انفلاميشن وهيلينج باي سكارز وهكذا يبقى ممكن يكون سيرفايكوفيشال اكتينومايكوزيس ممكن يكون ثراسيك اكتينومايكوز ده بتبقى مشكله طبعا انت مش هتشوف الحاجات دي لكن يعني انها بتعمل لانج انفكشن نيمونيا ممكن تكون ابدومينال اكتينومايكوز تعمل ابدومينال اتفقنا ان الاورجانيزم موجود في الاورال كافيتي تاني في الاورال كافيتي في الجات يا في كومنسال في الجينيتورينري فممكن يعمل الحاجات ايه ليجنز في الحاجات دي كلها لما تتوفرت لي ظروف ايه المناسبه لان اتفقنا ان هو اوبورتونيستك ابدومينال اكتينومايكوز بعد التروما جات تروما او جات سيرجري يعمل انترا ابدومينال اور بيلفيك اكتينومايكوز وكان برضو اجين كان سبريد تو افري اورجان سيستم بيلفيك نفس الكلام سي ان اس نفس الكلام ممكن يسبب سوليتري برين ابسس وممكن توصل للسي ان اس او للبرين من اللنج او من اذر بريفيوس فورمز اوف اكتينومايكوز دي ده الكلام بقى اللي احنا ايه بنشرحه من شويه هنا مثلا على اليمين هنا الايد ديت اليد دي فيها اكتينومايكوز اهوت سويلنج اهوت وفي نلاحظ الخروم دي او البيتس دي الايه الثقوب اللي بتستشارج الساندي وايت بتاع ده سلفر جرانيولز ها اليلوش جرانيولز ده في الهاند طبعا هنا ايه احنا قلنا ان الاكتينومايكوز اكتينومايس داز نوت ليف اون ذا سكين دي ار نوت سكين فلو فواضح ان ده اي حصل له انفكشن من منطقه ثانيه من 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 ليجن اخر ها حصل له انفكشن هنا اللي هو السيرفايكوفيشال اهوت ابر ليفت اللي هي السيرفايكوفيشال ليجن والسلفر جرانيوز خارجه بتاع تحت برضو هنا on the left side multiple sinuses discharging esophagus and a طيب احنا لو خدنا الدياجنوز بتاعها ازاي؟ لو احنا خدنا السلفر جرانيولز عملنا جرامستين اتفقنا هنلاقي كاركترستيك مورفولوجي اللي اتشرح قبل كده. عشان اعمل كلتشر هو فاكولتيف انيروب دو نوت كونتامينيز سبيسمن ويز فلورال اكتينومايس. خد الليجن غير ما تعمل كونتامينيشن ل العينه بالفلورا بتاعتك. فبتقعد 1 to 2 weeks white colonies like top of molar tooth زي ما انتم شايفين كده دي الكولونز اللي بتبقى طالعه. ممكن نعمل برضو ايه بلاد كلتشر ممكن لو في العيان عنده ترانزنت بكتيريا. هتقولوا لي احنا بنعمل ايه انيروبيك بلاد انيروبيك كلتشر علشان في وان ستريم بيبقى انيروبيك بين زي ويل جرو اون ايروبيك اور انيروبيك اوكي. لكن اكشولي هي فاكولتيف انيروب وبتجرو بيتر على الانيروبيك. كل سترينز بتجرو احسن بتنمو اسرع بالانيروبيك كونديشن. عارفين طبعا ان هي بتاخد لها اب تو 2 ويكس في الجروس فعشان كده ايه بنفضل نزرعها انيروبيك علشان تجرو بسرعه. طيب التريتمنت طبعا لازم ايه الابس ازاي يتفتح يتعمل له سيرجيكال ديبرايدمنت وياخد برلونج ثيرابي اوف بنسلين. لو مش هيقدر ياخد بنسلين عنده الرجي بنسلين ممكن ياخد اريثروميسين او كلينداميس. ممكن طبعا هنا بروفيلاكتيك انتيبيوتيك وين لما يكون العيان داخل انفيزيف سيرجيكال بروسيجر داخل على انفيزيف بروسيجر فقبلها بيومين تبتدي تغطيه ببروبر انتيبيوتيك.